Welcome to module number 4 of Point Set Topology course. So today we shall take up one of the important concepts, namely continuous functions on metric spaces. Starting with the idea or whatever we have learned, our basic lessons in real analysis of functions, real valued functions of real number, how you define continuity there using epsilon delta definition, without any effort, exactly same definition can be adopted here for continuity. So, and that will be called epsilon delta definition of continuity. You know it already, so I am recalling it actually here. Take a function f from x1 d1 to x2 d2. What does that mean? That means that x1 is a set and d1 is a metric on it. x2 is a set, d2 is a metric on it. The function is a set theory function from x1 to x2. Take a point x1 in x1. A function f will be called continuous at x1 if the following happens. What is that? So that is the epsilon delta part. For every epsilon positive, there exists delta positive such that d1 of y1 x1 less than delta implies d2 of fy1 fx1 is less than epsilon. x1 and y1 are inside capital X1 obviously, and I am applying D1 to that. That distance is less than delta implies the corresponding distance between f of y1 and f of x1. Now this time I have to take the d2 distance from for x2, that must be less than epsilon. If this happens for all points x1 in x1, namely f is continuous for all x1, at all x1s, x1 in x1. Then we say f is continuous on x1 or just f is continuous. Let f from x21 to x2 continuous means it is continuous at all the points. Okay. We also use the word map, which is a small word, compared to all continuous function. And so on. One of the important thing is, what is called as using the sequences, and that is again, very much available to us in the case of metric spaces also. Exactly same kind of definition, same kind of techniques, and so on. So let us make one more definition. What is the meaning of convergence of sequence in a metric space? Take a metric space XD, take a sequence XN in X. It is supposed to converge to a point X. I'm making a definition here. So XN converges to a point X inside X if the following thing happens. Once again, in terms of this epsilon and number k here. For every epsilon positive, you must have a natural number k such that all n bigger than or equal to k, dxn, x, the distance must be less than epsilon. So in other languages, after a certain stage, all the points of the sequence are close to x. What is this closeness? The distance is less than epsilon. If you remove this d and replace it by modulus, modulus of x n minus x, what you get is the definition of continuity for k valued functions, real or complex valued functions. Okay. So we have just done the other way around. You took the definition from complex analysis or real analysis, whatever you have learned. The modulus you have replaced by the distance function here, that's all. Okay. So whenever a sequence converges, we just write it in a very simple way, xn arrow x. So this I can read it as xn converges to x over. Then all these conditions are inside my mind. Okay. So by just this symbol, we are expressing all this idea. Now I am going to give you the equivalence of this epsilon delta definition with the what is called a sequential continuity. Okay. So start with function f from x1 to x2. Again, take a point x inside x1. F will be continuous at x if and only if for every sequence xn converging to x, the sequence fxn must converge to fx. Okay. So that is the condition. F is continuous. Take a sequence which must converge. Take a sequence which converging, f of xn must converge. If this happens for every sequence, then f must be continuous to x. Okay. So these two things are equivalent is displayed here, namely epsilon delta continuity is equivalent to sequential continuity. So let us go through the proof here so that these things become solid in your mind. Suppose f is continuous as x and xn converges to x, then I should show that f of xn converges to fx, right? So to show that, I take an epsilon positive, then I must produce a number k such that for n greater than equal to k, distance between fx to fxn and fx is less than epsilon. This is what I should produce. But what is the hypothesis? F is a continuous at x and xn converges to x. So given epsilon positive, first I take, using the continuity, I take a delta positive such that distance between y and x is less than delta implies d2 of fy and fx is less than epsilon. So I use the continuity here. Now I will use the convergence also, but this time I will replace epsilon by delta for this one. So delta is also a positive number. For that, I must get a k bigger than k belonging to some natural number such that n bigger than equal to k implies distance between xn and x is less than delta. So this is now playing the role of epsilon. This delta is playing the role of epsilon for the convergence here. So both the conditions I have used. Now you just combine them. Moment s is bigger than k, this distance is less than delta. But now I can put this y equal to xn. Then what happens? This is less than delta. So d2 of f of xn comma fx will be less than epsilon. That is this condition. So one way we have proved, namely continuity implies sequential convergence, right? So now we shall prove the other way around. The other way around is not all that straightforward, okay? Soon we can say these things are also straightforward. Straightforward itself is not all that straightforward. So here you have to use the contrapositive. You want to prove the contrapositive of the statement. Conversely, assume that f is not continuous, then produce one sequence which will violate the condition. That's all. Produce one sequence xn converging to x, but fxn does not converge to fx. So what I am going to prove here, assuming this is not true, I am going to prove this is not true. What is the meaning of this is not true? This statement says that for every sequence, something happens. So what is the negation of that? There is one sequence, this doesn't happen. So what is that? That is one sequence is converges, but fxn does not converge. So that is the final statement I have to prove. So I have to produce such a thing now. Okay. So this is where you have to learn what is the meaning of negation, what is the meaning of contrapositive, and so on. So I will give you 1 minute, all of you, to think about it and tell me what is the meaning of f is not continued at x. Just write it down. I can't check it, of course. I will give you a minute and then I will proceed. Okay, so if you have done it correctly, congratulations. In any case, you can compare the answer that I am going to write down here. I am going to prove that there is a sequence xn which converges to x and fxn doesn't converge to fx, starting with the assumption that f is not continuous. Okay, so what happens? F is not continuous implies there is one epsilon positive for which blah blah blah, those things are not true. So what is not true? For every delta, you must get a point such that something happens. So that delta, for every delta, so I choose delta to be 1 by n. So that is what I'm doing. For every n inside n, there will be some xn. This depends upon the n I have chosen, such that the distance between x and n, x is less than 1 by n. So this delta I am taking as, now 1 by n, I can take any delta, because for every delta it is supposed to be true. There is, for every delta there is something. So for 1 by n there must be something, and that I am calling it xn. D1 of x1, xn, x1 is less than 1 by n. But what is it? The distance between fxn and fx is bigger than or equal to epsilon. If that were less than epsilon, there is nothing. So I have to say this, the whole condition is violated. Namely, f is continuous, it is not continuous at x1. That is what I have to say. So d2 of fxn, fx is bigger than equal to epsilon. This happens for one epsilon, then that is what it is, f is not continuous. Okay, but what I have got is, fixing one epsilon here, I don't know what it is, bigger than or equal to 0, that's bigger than 0, that's all. I have got a sequence now. This sequence automatically converges to x. F of xn, on the other hand, does not converge to fx, because it is keeping away from fx a constant distance bigger than or equal to epsilon. Over. Okay? The next theorem is one of the profoundest thing that we have to learn. Whereas in reality, it is just very, very simple. You will see that this proof is very simple. And if you use this one later on, lot of things become very simple. Okay. So this may be one of the things that, you know, why topology as a whole, comes into picture after all. But right now there is no topology, it's metric spaces here. F from x1 to x2, g from x2 to x3. So I can talk about g composite f, right? Suppose the function f is continuous at x1 and g is continuous at f of x1. I have write it as x2. Then g composite f is continuous at x1. So this also a theorem in real analysis as well as complex analysis. Proofs were identical there. The proof I am going to give here is also exactly same. The point is that it does not depend upon all that strong structures, real and complex numbers I have. It is just the metric that we are going to use. And that is why it is there. Okay. So look at the proof. I want to show that G composite F is continuous at x1. So I start with an epsilon. First, I use the continuity of the G, okay, at x2. That will give me a delta positive such that distance between x2, y2 is less than delta implies gx2 and gy2, the d3 distance less than epsilon. Okay. So this is the continuity of g at the point x2. X2 is what? F of x1. Now use the property that f is continuous at x1, this time using this delta again in the place of epsilon. So then I get a delta prime positive such that distance between x1 and y1 less than delta prime implies d2 distance now between fx1 and fx fy1 is less than a delta. Now, just like in the previous theorem, you combine them. Start from here, you get here. Now, play the role, these things will play the role of x2 and y2. This is already x2. Put y2 equal to fx1 here and use this equation number 3. This is an implication. So you all the way come here. But what is gx2? It is g composite f of x1. Similarly, what is this one? It is g composite f of y1. Because I have put y2 equal to f of y1 over. Okay, so this implies that g composite f is continuous at the point x1. Okay, so see, using combining these, we have used twice in some sense, right? There it is, it was for convergence of sequences and continuity. Here both of them are for continuity. Okay. So let us now do some examples kind of thing, but I will state them as theorems because they are very profound results. Okay, once again, we go back to real numbers or complex numbers. Take a sequence un converging to u and another one converging to v. Then if you take the sum sequence, un plus vn is another sequence, which is a sum of this sequence with that one, right? Un plus vn will convert u plus v. The product un vn will convert to uv. You remember this result or not in real analysis or complex analysis? Now here, this is what I am not going to prove in real analysis. You have this one. You can use this one to prove many things slowly. Okay, this you could have done in real analysis course also. If you haven't done it, now I am going to do that because those things are crucial for me. Okay. Addition and scalar multiplication inside K, right? K cross K to K, you take the addition or scalar multiplication. They are continuous. This is the statement. From convergence of these results about the convergence of the sums and products, I am concluding this one. How do I do that? Because continuity, I can convert it into sequential continuity. Okay, epsilon delta continuity is equivalent to sequential continuity. So what happens? I have to verify. Suppose you take, I have to show alpha is continuous, means what? Suppose you take a sequence here, okay, converging to u plus v, whatever, then alpha of that should convert to, that's what I have to show, right? So similar, for example, let us do this one here. Un converging to u, vn converging to v, un vn will convert it to u comma v. The product UNVN converges to UV, therefore it is continuous. When you have a product that's f of that, whatever, here it is mu, so here it's alpha. Okay, so use this theorem for both of them, namely this theorem, then you get these results that scalar multiplication and addition, they are continuous. Okay. So I will explain this one once more. Look at how to show that alpha of u plus v, alpha u is u plus v, how it is continuous. I have to take continuity at a point, u naught, v naught, if you want to take. Now how do? I have to take two sequences, u n converging to u naught, v n converging to v naught. Okay, then I have to apply alpha of these sequences. What is this? It is alpha of un plus vn. Where does it converge? It converges to u naught plus v naught. So I'm using that convergence to show that this one. So for every sequence converging to that, I have shown that alpha of the sequence converges to alpha of the limits, right? Therefore, alpha must be continuous. Similarly, for mu is multiplication. Okay, exactly same. Only thing is instead of plus, you take the product here. Okay. So let us stop here. Next time we will do all these things. We will use them and do a little more about examples of continuous functions. Thank you.